because of the bamboo effect, I've seen a drastic drop in, you know, the ability to slice.
If you're getting a machine to like a high-end printer that can do high-end materials, there's still work that needs to go into it. There's still experience. It's still a craft. AI and machine learning, hopefully we'll be changing that.
That actually makes me think of, look, I've got a bamboo. I love it. Why did I buy bamboo? I've got so many machines at home. Some I've built, modified, I don't have to do anything. It's the equivalent of buying a Honda Civic. And with a warranty and being like, okay, I'm just going to drive it and it'll work. Mm-hmm. And if it doesn't, I'll fix it. But what I have noticed is that because of the bamboo effect, I've seen a drastic drop in, you know, the ability to slice in
like people's ability.
Yeah.
Understanding.
When we did it, this sounds so gatekeepy, but the hard way, it's like, okay, I'll make this quick, but you and I are old. So we grew up with computer, old Windows 95, 3.1, no internet. And it was like, something goes wrong, you just have to figure it out. And now it's great that they don't have to, but I am seeing people, the critical thinking in terms of actual like complex slicing and stuff is you know, for the consumer, which they don't have to do, but it's like awesome. You can push a button and make it work. But I'm also seeing a loss of like expertise.
It's not necessarily important for, you know, like when I'm printing my nieces and nephews toys.
Not at all. It's not important.
Cool. I don't care as long as it stuck together. It worked. It's part. Cool. But when you get into like higher levels of manufacturing or serial production, you want to be able to go into that slice and make sure it's doing it efficiently. It's filling in all the gaps you need. It's not doing any weird stuff. Like being able to examine your G code to make sure your part's coming out right. And this is not new. I mean, to most of our customers in, you know, any kind of CNC field and stuff, they're examining their tool paths before they run that.
I love CNC. When someone calls asking about, you know, a huge, crazy complex printer. And they're like, well, yeah, I ran a CNC. And I was like, oh, perfect. I don't need to explain anything to you.
Yeah. They're used to working with, oh, G code, random settings. There's 70 different settings to, you know, that'll make an effect, but which ones do you need? It's a trait. It's a craft.
Well, I have to trademark it's the bamboo effect. Because I'm so glad the bamboo effect exists because so many more people are printing.
Oh, okay. Gosh. Yeah.
It has made it accessible.
Yeah.
So entirely. I think I am just gatekeeping.
Well, it's also demographics. It's like, you know, the guys that are putting parts up on satellites and whatnot. Our level of stuff isn't needed for the consumer market.
Have you seen the bamboo effect in the past year, or am I making this up? Like, have you heard clients be like, well, I've got a bamboo and it works?
Yeah, absolutely. Oh. It's almost rare these days to have a company call and be like, all right, so they're asking about whatever printer and, you know, okay, so do you guys have experience with FDM, you know, filament extrusion? And they're like, yeah, you know, we got the bamboo.
So say that, you're like, all right, so you don't. That's not true. I don't mean to gatekeep like that. But
so
it's like,
they come because the materials aren't available or the size of the bamboo is too small. No, that's pretty much it. It's always size and material capability.
So what happens to the industry when bamboo makes a large format printer? Larger. They never will.
Every other company makes their printer better to try and compete.
This is an interesting story. Years and years and years ago, some guy called and was like, hey, we have this new technology for bed leveling. It uses a laser. He was talking about LiDAR. And he reached out to us super early. And we're like, yeah, okay, well, we're pretty busy.
Ooh, Mark Force was doing it. Are you talking about the camera guy? The guy that had a camera for doing that?
Yeah, there was a guy that actually was doing the bed. And I was like, I wonder if they got bought.
Mark Force uses an actual laser of some kind. Bamboo's got the LiDAR.
You've been in this industry for a long time. So have I. You're kind of a pioneer cowboy. What is the one thing you really want to use your 3D printer for? I know what I want to make a body kit or custom body panels for a car.
The first thing that comes to mind is literally replacement parts. Parts where I don't want to have to go find it online, wait 2 days to get it. I want to scan it real quick and print it. Right now, the gap is pretty much the reverse engineering phase. We did that helicopter blade maintenance mount, and we did reverse engineer it and printed it, and then we just let's print the scan data, and it came out precise, exact. It was identical.
I just did that. I went from I was using the Pro HD, And it's this part for my neighbor's yard. It's a little plastic grate that goes over a light so that it doesn't break, blah, blah, blah. I scanned it, and I was like, by the way, my biggest shortcoming that I want to talk about is not being able to 3D model.
Mm-hmm.
CAD is killing me not knowing how to do. But I just scanned it. This is all within the software. I was like, look, I'm just going to put it on the print bed and print it. And it worked just fine. So no intermediate, just scan. This is the biggest tip is to buy a scanner. I don't care if it's a $200 one.
The most fun I've had with printers in the last couple of years is scanning people and two different things. One, printing miniatures of that person. It's awesome when you scan the person, then you print a little mini of them overnight, leave it on their desk, and they come in, and oh my gosh. Or friends, you know, like we did our jiu-jitsu guys.
Yeah.
We scanned them and we printed them full color with the gi and the belt and the skin and the hair and everything. And it was like super cool. Other little ones like this.
Me, if you're looking for me, it's in the...
This in particular, because what you'll see here, it's Master Yoda using the Force, but the face has been replaced with Jay. Many of you know Jay from a lot of our videos, so it's just super fun.
That brings me to the next thing, and that's who needs a 3D printer or could use 3D printing? And everybody, because you just have to get creative with it. I was talking to Kyle earlier, and it was like, why did I get a printer? And it was literally to make parts for my drone. Yeah. PLA propellers, and they worked. And I was like, this is neat. And that got the juices flowing to be like, what else could I do? And it's one of those things where once you have one, you're like, I'm imagining a scenario where a husband and a wife, or he's like, I want to buy a 3D printer. He's like, you'll never use it. What are you going to use it for? And you're like, I don't know.
Yeah.
And then after he uses it like twice, he's like, hey, I've 47 parts around this house I'm going to fix.
I mean, like planter pots.
Same goes for scanners.
I 3D printed a closable print in place, latchable soap container for my travel case. So like, I was like, instead of going out and buying one, I just found a design online, hit print, and a couple hours later I had a little case for my soap. I've printed a lot of mounts and brackets for the walls to hang up.
Yeah, we got
stuff hanging throughout here. I've got my hang drum up on the wall. I mounted my bike to the ceiling this weekend, and I 3D printed a dock cleat. So it's basically like a string.
I have 3D printers. Yeah, you know, I know exactly what
it's like.
It's
like a hook in the ceiling. Yeah, so I pull it up and then I get on the dock cleat. It's just a 3D printed dock cleat.
I'm always surprised at how not creative people are with 3D printers, but are with making money with 3D printers. You go on Etsy and you look at so many parts. I would think, as an additive guy, as the consumer would be like, well, I'm not going to buy that. It obviously looks 3D printed. Obviously, that's not the case.
I mean, dude, at the lowest level, there's the kid who bought the Creality and he modeled a VW bus and cut the top out, filled it with dirt, and put a flower in it. And he's selling these to soccer moms on Facebook Marketplace all day long for $50. That's two spools of filament. The dude is making money. He's in high school. You know, that's on a small scale.
I'm tempted to do it. I almost want to do like a video challenge where I'm going to make some money with this.
The amount of course, all our customers are making money with it, but firearms manufacturers, people making accessories in the firearms industry, holsters, grips, magwells, all kinds of stuff like that. Automotive industry, there's all kinds of stuff. People making their custom part. We did that one, the throttle body
lots
adapter
of under the hood stuff
for an R34 Skyline. And it was like, this part is, there's three places online that sell it, and eBay, and everybody's completely out of stock, and nobody has the part. He had the drawing. He sent us the model. We printed it in three materials. It's on the car now. I think he brought a printer, and he can sell them. But it's like, that's awesome.
The fact that the machine at home, or maybe a bit fancier one, you know, than a standard bamboo, you can be doing underhood applications all day long, for the most part.
Which ones?
I'm just saying, using like a high quality, like HTNCF 25 or a high temperature nylon, you can do underhood applications all day long. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's not, it
intake
can't manifolds. Be against the block.
There's guys doing a lot of intake manifolds in polycarbonate carbon fiber, PCCF and HTNCF. That's a big one.